be thrown out or not? Yes. What kind of? Who? Who is? Okay. Now I'll come to that part very simple in a way. This is exactly, if I just ask another question, shouldn't India be united or not?
Yes.
So these are the kind of questions which are posed. These are the kind of questions which are posed to, which become a yes or no questions for the people. And you are compelled and forced to reply in yes or no answers. You say either yes or no to these questions. Because when it was told, it was asked whether black money should be eliminated or not, nobody asked what is black money. What is black money? Unaccounted money. Anything else?
Untaxed,
unaccounted. Anything else? Illegitimate earning. So yeah, so these are the two kinds of black money that are there. One is the money that is obtained through illegal means, that is terrorism, mafia, drugs, corruption, all this would become your illegal means, earning money through illegal means. The other is the undocumented money part. I think there's some issue with the sound. The undocumented money part would be, so if you have taken an auto rickshaw from your home to come here, you would have given some 100 rupees or 200 rupees to him, that is undocumented. You purchase some vegetables from a ready or some, you know, that vegetable cart, you give 100 rupees and purchase that, that is undocumented. You go to a clinic, a small clinic, that is undocumented. The ladies, many a times, it's a common practice in India, they try to save their money in the kitchen, one of the jar or something, you keep 1000 rupees, the 500 rupees and keep saving it. It becomes sometime 20,000, 50,000 like that. Now that is an undocumented money because that is, there is no record of that money. So all these are undocumented money. So two kinds of black money. One is that which is obtained through illegal means, that is corruption, terrorism, drugs, mafia, etc. The second is the money which is actually largely a product of informal economy. Okay, all this is informal economy, that auto rickshaw and all those things. Now I'm going to ask this question again. Should black money be eliminated or not?
Which black
money? Your answer changed. Earlier all of you were very united in saying yes. And when you said yes, what came?
Demonetization
came. Because when the government asked you this question, should black money be eliminated or not, and you all answered in yes, and government came up with a policy solution which was demonetization. What did demonetization attack? It did not attack the first kind. It effectively attacked the second kind. Because that money which people are saving in their home, or the people which is undocumented, those are the kind of money suddenly the people understood, okay, this is black money. This is the kind of money the government was after. And we cannot, you know, save it, we cannot go to bank, we have to do a lot of things. And the people who are actually earning in this the other way, they found ways to how to circumvent this whole demonetization process. The people who actually suffered were the common people who were legitimately saving, but unaccounted or undocumented as far as government is concerned. This is not an illegal activity. That's not an illegal activity. That's an informal economy. And in India, it's more close to 90% is informal economy. That's known to everybody. Now, that is why whenever you are given a yes or no question, you should not be compelled to answer it in a yes or no way. As a citizen, you can always ask a counter question to a question. You don't need to answer it always. You can always ask a question back. So I'm going to ask this question again. Should India be united or not? In what way? What do you mean by India uniting? Because when you ask this question is when the 370 thing happens and Kashmir becomes UT and people become, fundamental rights become taken away from them, and you feel we'll all feel yes is the answer, and yes. And what the government says, you only said yes, we are trying to do what you wanted me to do. You gave the permission, you demanded me to do that, and that's why we are doing it. Third,
Should illegal immigrants be thrown out or not? Who are illegal? The slight extension of that question is, how will the government know who is illegal? How will the government know who is illegal? Let's say you are in the government side. How would the government decide who is illegal and who is not? Data, yeah. You send, a government would send agents. Where? Okay, so that is, and then how do they know? Investigate and then? How do you investigate? Huh. Yes, but how? Let's say you are the person who is going, then how? Documents. Basically, it will all, anything government would, you know, if I want to know whether you exist or not, see, a retired person would go to get his pension, okay, and they would say produce, he will be going himself. They would say give your life certificate. Him going is not sufficient. He has to produce the life certificate that I am alive. Then only the pension would come, right? In one of the cases, actually, the previous year's life certificate was not given. This year's life certificate was given, and then they went to take the pension. They said, but your last year's life certificate is not there. So you produce that first, then only this year's can be processed. Because you are, it could be quite possible that last year you are not alive, but this year you are. So government functions with documents. Okay? So a person, that means what? Who is an illegal immigrant? A person without documents. So I'm going to ask this question again. Should people without documents be thrown out of this country or not? Should people without documents be thrown out of this country or not? What kind of documents? 30, 40, 50 year old documents. Okay? Now we are going to reframe this question again. Should people without 50 year old documents be thrown out of this country or not? Definitely no. It's the same thing. It's the same question. You just expanded it. You just went beyond that questioning, yes or no part. You went beyond that and you understood what is it that they want to do. And then you understood, okay, this is what the government is trying to say. When they're saying illegal immigrants, this is what they're trying to do. When they're saying black money, this is what they would effectively do. Who are the people who will not have these 50-year-old documents? Poor, illiterate, landless labor, very good. Tribals, people who lost their very disasters, floods, many kind of, yes. Refugees, yes. Homeless, yes, man, very good, yes. Displaced for riots, whatever reason, yeah, disaster also. Migrants, people who are going for a job in, you know, different big cities and living in slums and like that. Trade, okay, yeah. One major chunk is missing. Trafficked, yeah.
Systematically oppressed.
Systematically oppressed. Which is the largest section of people who are systematically oppressed? Largest section of people who are systematically oppressed. Women. So, women generally don't have documents. Because they marry and then they go to another village and a distant village, etc. Effectively, their identity becomes of that person's wife or this person's daughter or, you know, that's it. So when they go travel this thing, they don't carry 50-year-old documents to those places. They just go there. That's it. It will be difficult to. So now I'm going to ask this question. Should women without documents? Should tribals without documents? Should landless laborers without documents? Should people who are displaced without documents? Should people who are trafficked without documents, should people who are migrants without documents, should all of them be thrown out? This is what NRC is about. How would the government identify. No, these people will not be thrown out. None of them will be thrown out. But their citizenship will be taken away. When the citizenship is taken away, they will still get it back. In the first list, their name might not be there. Then you appeal, then you go, and the second list, it might be there. If it is not there in the second list, the third list, it might be there. But even for a night, even for a second, even for a day, does the government have any right to take a person's citizenship away? Whose responsibility was to ensure that the person has all the documents? Government. Now, the government's inability to ensure that he has documents is the reason why government is taking the citizenship away from him. How is that acceptable? And how we are responding to it? We are responding by making these documents. We are saying which are those documents that you have to make, and then we are suddenly starting to do that. Let's say the power goes off now, okay? Or just like the mic malfunction, the power goes off now. How would you respond? You'll say, oh, power gaya, that's it. And then in half an hour or an hour later, the power comes back. How do you say? Will you be happy or not? That is our mentality. When the power goes, we don't get angry because we are used to it. We have been used to things being taken away, which ideally is our right. We are okay with it. But what is your right when it comes back? What shouldn't have gone in the first place? When it comes back, you feel happy. You feel, hey, yes, power has come back. Man, yes, great, half an hour, power has come back. Nobody is angry when it went. That's what happens with this case also. You will feel sad when you lose your citizenship. You will not feel angry. You will feel, and you, our, the way our mentality works, our in, we think is that it must be our fault that we don't have these documents. Government would ask for 5 documents, we will feel one of them will not be there, and if it, it's our fault. We will have 4 documents, all the 4 will have 4 different names. I have 4 different names in 4 different documents. If the same person who put 4 different names is the person who is going to say, these 4 documents don't match, so you are doubtful citizen. So when that happens, and your citizenship is taken away, and then later, when you are granted it, when you are given it back, you will feel happy. You will feel grateful. Oh man, my citizenship is given back to me. Something which shouldn't have been taken away, is taken away in the first place, put, then it, when it gives, comes back to you, you feel happy. One thing I have to be clear, when the whole thing NRC affected, did any community came, Muslim community come in any of the people who's affected? When you took the names of Dalit, Adivasi, women, we never said Muslims, right? Because NRC is not anti-Muslim. It was not. NRC is not anti-Muslim. NRC is anti-poor. NRC is anti-women. NRC is anti-tribal. NRC is anti-landless laborers. NRC is anti-migrants. What makes it anti-Muslim? Citizenship Amendment Bill. Very correct. Because what is essentially an anti-poor exercise is being sold or marketed in an anti-Muslim way through the Citizenship Amendment Bill. The Citizenship Amendment Bill, it's not a new thing. What are the 2 kinds of citizenship? By birth and acquired. That is a little, that comes a little different way. There are two things very simple. That is just soli and just sanguine. Just soli means by birth of the soil. Okay? We say also, we are born in this soil, you know, we feel attached to this soil. And the other is by descent or blood. This debate that we are right now having was the debate, the same debate we had in our Constitutional Assembly debates also. And we decided that we'll go ahead with a soil-based citizenship. Okay, at that point of time itself. That somebody who was born in this country will be a citizen here. Afterwards, we slowly moved in 1987, after the Assam Accord happened,
we moved towards a sanguine or dissent based, because there was a lot of push during that. And after Assam Accord was done, we said the illegal immigrants who are there, who must have come from Bangladesh, we would change. 87 is the first time we said it's not only necessary that sufficient that a person is born here, it is also sufficient that both the parents should not be illegal. One of the parents should be an Indian. That part came. Then later it got amended and said 2003 that it's not sufficient that one person is an Indian, parent is an Indian, the other parent should not be an illegal immigrant. Okay? It does not say both have to be citizens of the country. It says one has to be citizen, the other should not be an illegal immigrant. Till then there is no religion coming in the thing. It is applicable for everybody. But now with this amendment, what is happening for the first time, our citizenship is going to be religion based. Because it says, now there are two kinds of illegal immigrants, what the government is trying to say. If you are an illegal immigrant, but not a Muslim, if you are a non-Muslim immigrant, you are a refugee. If you are a Muslim immigrant, you are a infiltrator. If you are a non-Muslim, then you are a refugee. If you are a Muslim immigrant, you are a infiltrator. Now once you come there, then the question becomes very simple. It's a dog thing. Should infiltrators be thrown out? To the Muslim, non-Muslim immigrants, let's say, what the government is saying, you will be considered as refugees. And if you are able to prove that you came from one of the three Muslim majority countries, that Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, then you will be considered as a refugee and you will be given a citizenship at the earliest. Imagine a person who is unable to prove that he is born and brought up in India because of lack of documents. First, that person is converted into a refugee. And then he is asked to prove that he came from Pakistan. And then only if he is able to do that, then a citizenship will be given to him. Citizen is converted to a refugee for lack of documents. I am talking about non-Muslim citizens. Non-Muslim citizens who are poor, etc., 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 for lack of documents will be converted to refugees. And then the citizenship may be granted by the government. So you will go to the government, apply, the government feels, yes, it will be a charity. Second is the Muslim immigrants. They are infiltrators because they don't have documents. They have to be now sent to infiltrators. So they have to be sent to detention centers. Not everybody can be sent, a few can be sent. It is not possible. What the government is very, very, very smartly trying to do, what essentially is its job? It was government's job and responsibility to identify and establish illegal immigrants. Through NRC, it is shifting the responsibility to the citizens. Earlier, government had to identify and establish who is an illegal immigrant. Now it is saying the people would establish that they are the citizens. How can the government say, I have to prove my citizenship? Government may prove that I am an illegal immigrant, but government has to do its job. Government cannot ask me to prove that I am a citizen. And if I am unable to prove that I am a citizen, then I am an illegal immigrant. No. That is just shifting your duty. It doesn't want to do the job. That's why they are shifting it to the public. Just like in demonetization. They should have identified and attacked what is the black money. Instead, they shifted the whole responsibility onto the entire population of this country. And that's why we are screwed. We are completely in this position. We have messed up thoroughly because what we did then. And again, we are going to do that. In Assam, NRC was done. 1600 crores official budgeted expenditure. 50,000 employees for 6 years. 6 years, 3 crore population, 1600 crores, 50,000 employees, 6 years effort, and the list was produced. And the list had close to 11-12 lakhs Hindus and 5 lakhs or something Muslims. So what they wanted to do, whatever they, it did not come out. Because ultimately government works on documents. And documents, it depends who is having, who is not having. Then they are junking that project. 8,000 crores, close to one of the reports says, 8,000 crores was what the citizens spent on proving they are citizens. Because they had to go to the places, district headquarters, here, there, appeal, second appeal, third appeal, government, changes in the names. 8,000 crores. And after all this, the list is junk. Who will be responsible for wasting that much money? Who will be responsible for putting so much of mental agony and anxiety onto the population? Just imagine tomorrow if you are asked, you are told you are not a citizen. Anybody of you is told you are not a citizen of this country. How would you feel? You'll not think about anything else. Only thing you will think about is how to get my citizenship back. So this is what the whole point is about, shifting the responsibility. Government wants to identify illegal immigrants, let them do it. They will identify, they will establish. The burden of proof should be on the government. The burden of proof should not be on the citizens to prove that they are citizens. And it will be going to be, if 3 crore took 6 years, imagine 130 crore how much it's going to take. 130 crore population. How long? 10, 20 years, we will have an anxious population without knowing what to do, how to prove their citizenship. And they're trying to do it to NPR also, in a different kind of a way. We'll come there later. I don't know why it is, why this kind of activities needs to be done. These are kind of really dumb, stupid, idiotic kind of decisions. I don't call it them evil. Evil would be giving them a lot of credit. This is dumb. It can be. It can be both. But one thing is sure, that it is dumb. Because demonetization, you know already what happened. GST, you know the way it came, you know what happened. It's like the running behind, you know, dogs running behind that car. They run, they reach till the car, then they don't know what to do. This government is like that, I feel so. They wanted to do this demonetization, but they did. But they don't know after that what. They wanted to shout, we did GST. They did GST, but after that what? They said it is the second independence. How many of you remember? On 12 o'clock in the night, parliament was opened and some bell was rung that India opens to another freedom. There is not another freedom. The entire country has, you know, given curses like anything. Nobody wants that freedom. Everybody takes that freedom back. We would like to be, you know, imprisoned. Then same thing, Kashmir also, 370. They did that. Now they don't know what to do. Because the people, proud people they are, they responded in a very different way. They thought they would be something and they would open it up and everybody would be happy and they would, the leaders, if they are promised to get out, they would start negotiating or the people would keep quiet. They don't know. Because government has to understand one thing, they are dealing with people. You go there with one macro innovation. In this country, the people respond with 1 billion micro innovations. Every single person becomes an innovator and tries to, you know, how to make that decision useless. And they have to understand that. It's a complete lack of imagination that they are coming up with these decisions. And that's why I feel it is not for the government, and to be put it in a different way, I don't think government has any right to ask me on my citizenship. I exist is sufficient enough proof that I am an Indian. There's no reason I have to prove to this government that I am an Indian. In whichever way, and I don't think anybody in this country should have to prove to this government that they are Indian. We all are here, that's sufficient enough proof. How to deal with it? Unless, you know, the kind of what we feel, there is an expression, you know, the large population has been quiet. Has been very quiet, and they're trying to sort of put, if by keeping quiet, if peace can be there, if harmony can be there, let it be that way. But that's not a sustainable kind of emotion. You know, when you are tensed and you are keeping quiet, that's not a sustainable emotion. At some point or the other, this will come out. It's important that the feelings are given its expression in a democratically acceptable way. It's important that it happens. And I am telling, we have to ensure, we have to tell this government that we will not let And more such exercises happen in this country and ruin this country for 10, 20 years. Because it's not a 5-year exercise. They might start it, but they will not be able to end the NRC. The list will go on for years. And then at some point they'll stop. And as concerned citizens, we have to tell the government in a democratically acceptable way. And I'm saying a democratically acceptable way means protest. Article 19 gives us a freedom to assemble peacefully and give our expression. That's an acceptable way in democracy. Thing is that we have stopped. If your own citizenship, the entire country's citizenship is also questioned, we would just keep quiet and find how to sort of take the documents away. We don't think that we have a right to question this government, we have a responsibility to question the government, and we have a duty to our next generation to say that we are not going to leave a country in which a large generation is a secondary citizen in this country. We have a responsibility for that. And for that, we have to tell. We might fail, we might succeed. But if that expression is out there in the open, someday the governments might change. Like in RA, some 200 young people, they protested. They knew they were going to fail.